Hey there, party people. It's your anonymous evil overlord here, but you can just call me Archie, and today we're going to be talking about something near and dear to my cold, dead heart. We're going to be talking about running liches. So without further ado, let's get right into it. So, liches are perhaps some of the most iconic villains in all of Dungeons & Dragons, and they are my personal favorite monsters to build. They're almost always wicked, filthy degenerates, frothing at the mouth to get their bony little hands on whatever scraps of arcane power they can manage to find. And this can often put them at odds with many of the parties that we find ourselves running a game for or playing in. But if you've ever actually run a lich in combat against those higher level parties, you're likely to have found that they probably got their shit pushed in. Taking all of this into account, and considering that our lich likely didn't even get to finish his cheesy Skeletor monologue, it's probably safe to assume that this encounter wasn't nearly as cool as it could have been for everyone involved. But today, my friends, I'm gonna teach you a little something-something to make those lich encounters really worthy of that spooky BBEG status they deserve. So without further ado, let's get started. Now, let's begin by taking a quick once-over of the lich stat block in the 5e Monster Manual, and let's see what we can glean from it. Firstly, as far as the base ability scores go, the lich is pretty solid, but it's nothing crazy for sure. It sports mediocre strength, good dex, con, and charisma. It has decent wisdom and stellar intelligence. Keeping in mind that most liches are supposed to be crazy-ass galaxy brain wizards that tore their own souls out to be edgelords for eternity, I think these ability scores are at least a good baseline. Aside from that, our lich sports a solid set of skills, great save proficiencies, true sight, high passive perception, good immunities and resistances, although I think it's kind of fucking stupid that he doesn't have immunity to necrotic damage, so that's something I give them. And it seems our boy's got some Rosetta Stone, because he knows quite a few languages. Coming in standard for these high-level boss monsters are the legendary resistances and actions. The Lich's legendary actions are okay, but they're nothing to write home about, although Disrupt Life can be good in certain situations, and as per the standard for this CR, the Lich has 3 legendary resistances, which will allow it to make up for any saves it might roll bad on. But enough being positive, let's get to all the shit that we want to complain about, shall we? If you're just running this stat block raw, you've got a 17 AC and roughly 135 hit points against high-level players. I mean, it really seems like our bone boy needs some milk, bro. I mean, think about it. Like, fuck an entire party. A single level 10 to 15 player can eat that HP for breakfast in a single action if they're built well enough. And that's no bueno if we're trying to use a lich as a BBEG. So, we gotta beef this boy up. We gotta give him that calcium. But how exactly are we gonna accomplish that? Well, strap in, homies, because lich class, it's now in session. Now, if your first reaction is just to increase the lich's hit points, go sit in the corner and think about what you did. I'm gonna show you that you actually don't need to do that if you've got a couple brain cells to spare. Firstly, we're going to pimp out our lich with some crazy-ass items. After all, it would make sense that an immortal, powerful magic user on the cusp of demigod status would have some sick-ass items, right? So, what are some good choices? Well, feel free to get creative and mean, but I'm going to try and do this all with items from raw D&D just to prove a point. The first item I love to give any good lich is the good old reliable Staff of Power. This requires attunement, of course, but the Staff of Power will give our lich a bunch of extra spells to cast that already make our bone boy way more legit, with a +2 magical bonus to their magical attacks, a +2 bonus to their saving throws as well, and +2 to their AC. Now we're cooking, and we're just getting started. With this item, our boy's AC is sitting at a crisp 19, and he has a +14 to hit with his spell attacks. Spicy! Now, the Staff of the Magi is a super powerful pick too, but I still find the bonus to the AC just too good to pass up, since you have to keep in mind, our bone boy needs all the survivability he can get. For our second item, we'll be going with a set of Robes of the Archmagi. These f***ers slap, dog. Firstly, this is going to get our bone boy's base AC up to 18 before we start adding the protections. Big note, this will also give our lich advantage on saves against spells and other magical effects because, for some reason, he doesn't already have it. Lastly, it's going to add another +2 to our lich's spell save DC, which means our big bad bony boy will be rocking a colossal spell save DC of 22. Yeah, pretty f***ing brutal. Just keeping track, this will be our second attunement slot used. For my third item, I used to go with a Ring of Protection. It's simple. You get a +1 to your AC and saving throws. Boom. That's it. I mainly chose this one to get that extra bump to AC because I always found my players hitting me right at 20, way more than 21, although this is anecdotal. An alternate option you could go with is a ring of spell storing if you're trying to be a cheeky bastard and you think you know what your players are trying to do. It lets you store up to 5 levels of spells within this little ring, which use the caster's stats for the bonuses and the DCs. There's some mean little tricks you can use with this little thing, especially if you use it to counter something you think your party might do. Maybe using it to store a cheeky greater invisibility spell, or a nice wall of force to get the hell out of a hairy situation if our bone boy's getting clapped. There's a ton of spells for wizards, so don't feel scared to do something cheeky. Another good choice for a third attunement slot would be an Arcane Grimoire +3. This gives us a +3 to our spell attacks and our saving throw DC. This item is no joke, and it's super f***ing scary with our spell bonus being a +17 to hit. And our spell DC is now sitting at an insane 25. Yikes. Especially if you have our bad boy prep some cheeky mind control spells and illusions, your party better make sure they're prepared to fight this guy or they're not going to have a good time. I found myself gravitating to this item more and more recently for my liches because they can usually make do with a 20 AC, and with such a nutty save DC, when Skeletor decides to throw out his dominate monster at the barb or tosses a feeble mind at the cleric, they are very likely to fail those saves, which can throw a wrench in the party's plans real quick. This item, when combined with our other gear, is legitimately f***ing terrifying. Now that we've got all the big ticket magic items out of the way, I'll run a quick list of some of the items that a lich might have on hand. Pick and choose what you like. These are mainly just wands and spell scrolls, as I don't let liches benefit from potions since they're like, you know, dead. Feel free to pause. Alright, wasn't that great? I sure had fun writing all of that crap. But finally, we get to the part of the video where we talk about tactics. Now, we're going to break this down into two parts. First, we'll talk about the battle tactics, and second, we'll write an essay about protecting a lich's phylactery and what that should look like, in my opinion. Let's talk about battle tactics. This is really what makes a lich a lich, and how you approach these fights is paramount if you're trying to play a lich right. So firstly, we have to work under a big assumption. The lich is probably smarter than you, the DM, and that means they're going to have some crazy contingency plans. If they're going into a fight, they should be prepared, not just with items, but with a ready-made game plan as to how they are going to pick the party apart. Even if the party somehow stumbles upon the lich unexpectedly, they're still going to have a general setup and plan for your average adventurers that they may expect to encounter. Here, it's going to be important to weave an intricate hellscape of glyphs of warding with all the types of gnarly spells that play off each other in the worst ways. Some good combos are Cloud Gill and a Wall of Force, Symbols of Death and Pain, Counterspell glyphs keyed to go off on specific spells and spells of a certain level, Feeble Mind glyphs that auto-target anyone who casts a spell, that have their own counterspell glyphs to protect them in case someone tries to stop it with a counterspell. Plane Shift runes to the worst places you can think of are also fun as well. And these are just some particularly mean combos I thought of, so I'm sure you can come up with more interesting ideas of your own once you get to the drawing board. Another big must for liches is a plethora of minions. There's a lot of different routes you can go for, such as devils, demons, undead, constructs, and much more. They can have any combinations of creatures like these at their disposal, and they will almost always definitely be leveraged in a fight with a lich. Shield guardians are good for helping to protect the lich, and iron golems or higher undead can always be used to make fights especially scary when fighting the lich on its terms, and the party will almost always be fighting the lich on its terms unless the lich is desperate for some reason. It's important to understand that the lich is going to have a crazy set of contingencies and defenses for its lair, and a party likely shouldn't be able to barge in there and expect to win. Speaking of contingency, the lich should also always have a contingency spell on them to compensate for some weakness or possible outcome they may wish to circumnavigate. I often use a sending spell to a construct in a demiplane that will then activate a glyph of warding containing a wish to transport the lich to said demiplane and to get it out of a sticky situation. Usually I tie it to a keyword or activation phrase the lich must mutter or think. Overall, don't be afraid to be smart and cruel with how you use these setups, as a lich is a super intelligent wizard that definitely will have access to most, if not all, of the vanilla wizard spell list. Now on to the second, and likely most lengthy topic at hand. How does a lich protect its phylactery? Well, I'm glad you asked, because this is the most gnarly way I could figure out how to do it with just the spells in the book, and a couple hundred years of nothing else better to do on the lich's part. So get ready. This is going to be pretty crazy, but keep in mind that if you can think of it, the lich probably thought of it way quicker. I'm going to use an example of a lich that I made, personally. The lich's name is Xanax the Eternal. Yes, I named him after the medicine, because medicine names are actually a life hack for wizards. Here's what I wrote for Xanax's magical contingencies. Contingency 1, the intermediary demiplane. The first challenge is actually getting to the phylactery. For this, I've had Xanax do a couple of things. Xanax has an intermediary demiplane that he keeps. This is the plane that he will plane shift to, with a special tuning fork that he keeps on him. The tuning fork is enchanted with an instant summon spell, and the respective gem to summon it is located in Xanax's prime demiplane. Xanax specifically plane shifts to this plane, rather than using the demiplane spell to get to the main plane, so that those spying on him can't actually see the demiplane, and then get access to it later by casting their own spell of demiplane. Before entering the intermediary demiplane, Xanax casts the spell non-detection on himself in order to avoid any scrying that those spying on him may do. The intermediary demiplane has details as follows. The room is 30 square feet, as per the details of the demiplane spell. The room is glyphed, and contains the following glyphs. There are 20, with 10 on each side, glyphs of warding, all storing a cloud kill spell. This means that one creature on each side of the room would take about 50 d8 or 100 d8 if they were standing in the middle of the room, damage, poison damage of course, each round at the DC of the lich. They're all triggered by anyone other than Xanax, unless Xanax says a passphrase and declares them not a threat. There are also 15 different symbols, as in using the symbol spell. 5 of each. Again, the same spell DC. They are of insanity, pain, and stunning. And they are triggered by any being that isn't Xanax that enters, unless Xanax says a passphrase and declares them not a threat. You can distribute these evenly as you see fit amongst party members during a fight. Lastly, there's a glyph of warding containing the sending spell that warns Xanax that there are intruders in the intermediary demiplane. The same trigger conditions are of as the other spells. This means that there won't only be a hail of spells trying to kill anyone who enters this room that isn't the lich, but also, if anyone does still successfully enter this room, the lich will know about it and be able to respond appropriately. Contingency 2. Entering the main demiplane and phylactery chamber. After entering, Xanax will then cast the demiplane spell. This will be the door that then leads to his main demiplane where his phylactery is stored. The room is again 30 square feet, as stipulated by the demiplane spell, and it is glyphed to all hell. Firstly, there is a sending glyph that will tell Xanax that someone is intruding in the phylactery room, and there are 8 other very important glyphs, first and second of which go off in a sequential order. For this first glyph, carved on the phylactery, it is a wish spell. It triggers should the phylactery be destroyed. The wish stipulates that the destruction of the phylactery be reversed. Wish allows for resurrection, so this should be fine at most tables. Second glyph, also carved on the phylactery. This activates when the first casts its spell, the first glyph that is, and it contains a plane shift spell that will then teleport the phylactery to a secure demiplane that is unknown to any creature other than Xanax. This room will have spare spellbooks in case Xanax has already been felled and hasn't regained a physical form yet. There's a third glyph carved on the phylactery. This is another plane shift spell that stipulates the phylactery be sent to the secure demiplane should it be touched or moved in any way by anyone other than Xanax. There are also 4 other glyphs in this room. They are counterspell glyphs, all at 9th level, should anyone attempt to counterspell the other glyphs, including the counterspells themselves. Also in this room are 20 symbols of death. That would come to roughly 200 d10 necrotic damage, all at the spell save DC of the lich. If they succeed, they halve this down to 200 d10 halved. There are also 20 glyphs of cloud kill. This is 100 d8 poison damage, and again, it uses the spell save DC of the lich that made them. There are also 4 glyphs of feeble mind. These target anyone who casts a spell other than Xanax. There are also 2 glyphs of power word kill, targeting anyone other than Xanax or his allies, that appears bloodied. there is also one glyph that shifts in a simulacrum on standby should the real phylactery be plane shifted successfully, or should the party approach the fake phylactery, as there is a fake phylactery in this room. The simulacrum will appear and defend the phylactery as if it were the real phylactery. The simulacrum will fully act as if the fake phylactery is the real one, and is to fight to the death defending it. There is a contingency spell on the simulacrum that casts Circle of Death should the simulacrum be destroyed in order to cover up the signs of it being a simulacrum. This will essentially seem as if he exploded in death. 3. Contingencies. Escaping capture. Like I said earlier, Xanax keeps a permanent contingency spell on him, worn as a necklace underneath his robes. At all times, it stipulates should Xanax be incapacitated, or think of an activation phrase, it will cast the sending spell to a clay golem that is in another demiplane. This golem is instructed by the spell to press a rune on a pillar in the center of the room. The rune is a glyph of warding containing a wish spell. This wish spell stipulates that Xanax and his inventory only, none of his bindings or anything else disabling him, be teleported to a secure demiplane full of spellbooks and other treasure. The phylactery enchantments and location. The phylactery appears as an ornate skull made out of pure emerald. Other than the aforementioned glyphs on the phylactery, Xanax will have an instant summon spell on the phylactery that will allow him to recall it to him whenever he wishes, should he feel the need. There will also be a sequester spell put on the phylactery, making it both invisible and undetectable by divination magic of any kind. Keep in mind, this means that detect magic will not detect this magic. In the demiplane where the phylactery is stored, the real phylactery is affixed to the ceiling of the room. There is a fake phylactery in the room, as previously mentioned. This phylactery will, for all intents and purposes, seem like a real phylactery. A permanent Nistel's magic aura falsely makes this phylactery seem legitimate. This phylactery will take the form of an immaculately crafted hourglass, and it sits upon a stone dais in the center of the room. The sand on the inside seems to be suspended in place, and has a purplish hue to it. Well, that was a mouthful, but here we are. As you can see, this will make a lich super scary if you're willing to put in the time. With all the steps they may take, and all the planning they're bound to do, the lich is finally worth that high CR after you put in a little love by leaning on their intelligence a bit. Well, after all that, I think I'm pretty worn out. Hopefully you found this useful out there, you rascals, and I look forward to hearing the horror stories of your parties underestimating your new megalich out there, crawling in some crack in the Earth's crust somewhere, greedily lusting after shiny magic items. So, until next time, this has been your boy Archlich, and I look forward to seeing you when next we meet. Stay safe out there, adventurers, and remember to never underestimate a lich.